Welcome back. This is Talk With... Yes, Gaetano. Thank you so much for joining me and my guest here in the studio on Urban Television. Abubakers Mayanja, financial economist at ABL Dunamis. And we're going to be now talking about an area which he's very comfortable with, or he's comfortable with all areas, and that has to do with Islamic banking. What is it? What's so different about it than normal banking? Well, let's find out. Abubakers, Islamic banking. You're with ABL Dunamis. But I want to know a little bit more about Islamic banking and the activity behind all of this and what makes it so different and what it offers.
Yes, Islamic banking originates from the belief that we should not charge interest. Interest is normally how the conventional banking system works. Now, the key idea behind Islamic banking is that every time somebody engages in business, they make a profit. And therefore, the financial should be sharing in that profit.
Wait a minute, Abubakers. You're saying a bank, well, as far as Islamic bank is concerned, you don't charge interest?
Yes.
But then you're not a bank. You're just a good Samaritan, just giving out money. I mean, really? How does that work?
Not quite.
Okay.
Yes. Because I think it's better to use very live examples. If you're a Coca-Cola seller and on each bottle, you make 100 shillings. If an Islamic bank funds you, they'll say, okay, on 100 shillings, for each 100 shillings you make, we will take 20 shillings. It is linked to the actual transaction, the charge. Now, what makes it fair and more appropriate for our type of economy is that it does not presuppose an existence of wealth. For example, right now when you go to a bank, you must have collateral.
This is what I was going to ask you. So you are working on the premise here of on actual, transactions that are done. That is where we'll take our little 20%.
Yes.
Not unforeseen.
Yes.
I don't have to have this huge collateral.
That's the key difference. The key difference is that an Islamic bank really analyzes a project to see the profit, and that's where they take their share from. And so the idea that you have a lot of collateral may not apply. Now, when you come to Uganda, we are an asset poor country in the sense that because we don't have a lot of money, a lot of people don't have assets to pledge in the bank. Now, a lot of people with good ideas go unfunded, like say the technology sector. Some of these young people who are innovating, sometimes they don't get funded because they don't have collateral. Now, Islamic banks may fill that gap because for them they look at the profit potential of a business and not necessarily collateral. And their charges or profits are shared with the profits that the entrepreneur makes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what makes Islamic banking more tricky is that if the entrepreneur loses money, then you cannot go and claim beyond what you invested. You can't go to their home. I'm told banks now even ask for personal guarantees on top of what you are borrowing. So I personally feel that the right time has come for us to diversify the kind of finance available to people through Islamic banking. And the government passed the law last year in February 2014, the Financial Institutions Act was amended. And now what we have been waiting for is for the central bank to pass the regulations, and then people can begin to see how this system works. Another thing Islamic banks don't do, they don't invest in some famous industries. Investment bankers tend to call them the sin industry. Now, these are huge industries. Casinos, alcoholic beverages, betting, and gambling. For them, they stay away.
They stay clear of those.
Those sectors, yes. Everything else, they fund. And sometimes they fund through buying shares in a company. And sometimes they fund the actual transaction. If somebody is buying a house and an Islamic bank funds them, the mechanism is that if you have paid 50%, then you only pay 50% of the rent until when you are able to pay it.
We use the term Islamic banking. Now, me, Gaetano Kagwa, I am not a Muslim. But do I have to be one to be able to use Islamic banking services?
No. That is why in some countries, last year we held a convention, and one of the matters that came about was that the term Islamic banking may be doing a disservice to a very good product. And in Nigeria, they call it interest-free banking.
Mm. Mm.
And in some other countries, they call it non-interest banking. And so in Uganda, non-Muslims need to know, because last year we had a gentleman from KCB, and he said that in Kenya, the biggest takers of Islamic banking products are non-Muslims. So it's got nothing to do. It's called Islamic because it originates from the principles of Islam, but it's a banking product, and it just works on a separate system than from interest, because interest, the outcome is not so important. The bank already knows what it's going to make, and then you also have to provide collateral. Whereas the Islamic bank takes a level of risk that if somebody is unsuccessful, then the principles and ethics of that banking system do not allow you to claim. And so Islamic banks tend to take a little bit more care before they do the business. But just to make matters very clear, it's not for Muslims only.
Okay.
It just happens to be called that.
Is the Islamic banking sector growing in Uganda? If so, is that why is it because the reasons that you've talked about? People are seeing it as being more beneficial and works for both parties in a much better way?
To an extent, yes, because there are some projects, like, for example, Islamic University in Uganda and others that have been funded directly by the Islamic Development Bank. And they also have a private sector arm that is willing to fund people with projects. And some of them we have been forwarding their applications directly to the ICD. They've also funded the process of forming regulations. Uganda is a member of the Organization of Islamic Countries since Amin's time. This means that for the 43 members, our goods enter tax-free. But the reason why they don't trade with us is because we finance our businesses using interest, and they don't like interest-based system.
Mm.
So I think that the congruence of Islamic banking and export is going to kind of allay some of the problems we're having right now in the economy.
Mm.
And the fact that the government passed the law is a positive sign that shows that they have acknowledged this. Now it's a question of implementation. And for example, in April, there will be a lot of international delegates coming here to discuss Islamic banking, all the big banks. Then I'm also told, or I know that some of the banks that exist already are also preparing. They are training staff, and they will open Islamic banking windows so that someone can have a choice.
That was going to be my next question. These other banks are having, like you said, their own sections of Islamic banking. And obviously, you've answered it by saying this is the direction that many banks in Uganda will be going.
Yes, from the perspective of a starting industry, we would be more comfortable if the conventional banks are the ones that started Windows. I'll tell you why. When you start a bank, there's a lot of capital outlay in terms of the branches, the staff. But when you work with a bank that is existing, then it would be a little bit easier to introduce Islamic banking in, say, the existing banks, as opposed to fresh ones starting.
Okay.
It'd be more competitive. Mm. And even because they have expertise and clientele and branch network, the spread and reach of Islamic banking would reach faster.
Okay. Mm. Products, we've got about 2 minutes to go. Some of the good products in 2017 that we can look forward to as far as Islamic banking is concerned. Can you give me some light on that?
Mm. One of the most important things is a home for everybody. So Islamic banks have a mortgage product. And that mortgage product works differently from the interest product in that you kind of share the responsibilities of payments. I'll give you a very live example. If I buy a house and I pay half of the price, what I would have been paying in rent, I start paying half of the rent.
Mm.
And because I own 50%, the half of the rent goes to the Islamic bank. But the Islamic bank gives me an option to keep buying more of the share of that house.
True.
Until when I complete that.
Okay.
Then we'll have asset finance, which is called Ijara.
Ijara. Mm.
So for example, if you want to start a production company and you don't have equipment, the Islamic bank can buy the equipment, and then you share the profit. that is coming from. Yes, then we have the most common one, which is a trade finance product. We can go back to the Coca-Cola trader. If you're buying the bottle at 200 and selling it at 300, the Islamic bank will go and buy it from Coca-Cola at 200 and give you the sodas, and then you sell and you share the profit.
I see.
It's as simple as that. That is as simple as that. Of course, like all things, there's risk management, but those are the complex thing. To understand it simply, the most common Islamic finance products is for traders.
Okay.
The bank actually buys the goods, then puts them in your charge to sell. And every time you sell, you share the profit. And then the cycle.
Before I let you go, obviously, you've given us quite a lot of insight into how Islamic banking works. As an individual out over there who's interested, watching the program is saying, okay, I want to sort of get engage myself with an Islamic banking service. What are the first steps? Where do I go? Who do I see? Can we come straight to you? Is there a number? Is there somebody out over there who are, you know, where do we start?
Oh yeah, starting at ABL would be beneficial for you because we would be able to point you in the right direction. But even the banks, some of them are preparing. But right now, we also have initiatives in the microfinance sector. There are SACOs, about two of them, that are using this system of Islamic banking. Like all new things, it will take time, but the first place, of course, is your bank. You can ask them. And then even us, we are handling some projects for
as
some
ABL
clients, as ABL Dunamis,
Dunamis
in an agency capacity.
Okay.
Then we're also organizing the Islamic Finance Convention, where international players will be here in April, and some members are more than welcome to come to that, and maybe we can have more media coverage of it than we had last time, and so that people get to learn more.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. ABL Dunamis, if you are interested in finding out more information as far as Islamic banking and that system and how it works, you got our man over here, Abubakar Mayanja, who sits at ABL Dunamis. Go and see him or sit down with your own bankers to let you know exactly how that works. Abubakar, I want to let you go. I'm sure your daughter is waiting for you at home.
Thank you.
All right. You have time to go and play with her. I want to thank you so much for coming in to talk with Gaetano. I do appreciate it. All right. And with that, we're going to leave you wishing you a very good night. Until the next time, take care. Bye-bye.